Alrighty, so the expansion draft just happened today, and as it is the case, whenever we have an expansion draft, I, of course, will take a look at these expansion team in terms of the five players that they, of course, would pick. Now, there are definitely more to the review that I'm going to be talking about the expansion draft, and that, you know, after the expansion draft, we did see a couple of trades as has happened between both Inter Miami and Nashville to other teams, but I'll save that when I get to the news of the week video when I do that tomorrow. But let's start off with Inter Miami in terms of their expansion draft and see who exactly they picked. And, you know, this year, the expansion draft definitely isn't as deep as it was in previous year, but there's still some very quality player that I think both of these teams could have selected. And one thing that I also kind of look at in terms of this year expansion draft is that I see both of these teams are very value in terms of trying to draft a fullback or a center back or even a midfield during this draft, because there wasn't a lot of striker or central attacking mid player that was selected in this draft. In fact, Inter Miami didn't really select a central attacking mid, except if you count Lee Quinn as one of those players. But, you know, they start off their first draft pick, and keep in mind, these draft pick in the or in terms of the order doesn't really matter. This is not like the NBA draft or the NFL draft, where if you go the first overall pick, then that means that you are going to be more valued than if you're pick number 7 or number 8. That's not how it works in the expansion draft, as this is basically teams are looking at the unprotection list and trying to pick like these 5 players, and then eventually they, of course, would announce it one by one. But the first pick they select was Ben Swift from NYCFC, and he is a left back. And, you know, there was definitely a couple of good options for NYCFC for both of these teams to pick. You know, besides Ben Sweat, they could have gone with Jesus Medina or gone with Abiaga in that center back role, but it seemed like Miami decided to go with Ben Sweat, and Ben Sweat is definitely one of the better fullbacks in this expansion draft, in that, you know, as I said, I think both of these teams really want to get their fullbacks in this expansion draft, knowing for a fact that, you know, it's very hard for teams to get trades done in terms of looking for a fullback, since there isn't really a lot of very good ones. And that if you're going to try to get a good one, it's going to definitely cost you a pretty penny. So that's why teams in this expansion draft are really looking at who exactly the fullback is going to be available, and that they're going to select them so that they, of course, will be starters. And they also mentioned that, you know, I know in previous expansion draft we've seen some of these players that's been selected that usually they are not like regular starters. I mean, there are a couple that are regular starters, but eventually they kind of got faded out. But when I look at this expansion draft, I can definitely see some players that could be regular starter. And Ben Sweat, I think he could be a regular starter for Miami, knowing the fact that he, as I said, he's a very reliable fullback, and for me, considered one of the best fullback in this league. Then they go with another fullback, and this time they actually decided to get Alvis Powell from FC Cincinnati. Now, you know, this was an interesting one because, you know, Alvis Powell, he definitely did not have a good year for FC Cincinnati. And then FC Cincinnati was really hoping that he can be as good as he was with the Timbers, and it turns out he wasn't. So I'm kind of interested to see why they decided to go with Alvis Powell. And that you got to also keep in mind, Miami was the first one to be able to look into the unprotection list and pick those 5 players, and that there was definitely other option that they could have gone with. So, you know, this was definitely an interesting thing, one that they gone with, but we'll see if that, of course, will work out. Then they gone and get Lee Quinn from LAFC, and I think out of all the players that has been picked in this expansion draft, this one is probably a no-brainer. I mean, you know, I think a lot of people would have thought that Lee Quinn was going to be picked up, considering the fact that, you know, I think he, even though he's already near the twilight of his career and that he's already 33 years old, he's still a very dynamic attacking midfielder and definitely a very creative player for Inter Miami, and that You know, you also bring in kind of the experience in there. And that, I think LAFC, the reason why they decided to leave him unprotected is because they want to get rid of that massive contract that they, of course, is currently on for league wins. So that's why they kind of leave them. And I think they're happy the fact that one of these team was able to select him. But at the same time, either of these team that select league win, which in this case was Inter Miami, got a good deal out of him because, like I said, he is a guy that even though he's getting old and that, you know, I think in a couple of years he is going to start to slow down a little bit and not as a prolific kind of player as he was in the past couple of years. He's still a very good, decent attacking midfielder, and that, you know, depend if Inter Miami decided to splash the cash in terms of the attacking side, which I'm assuming they're going to be, maybe Leguin could be a good option off the bench. Then they decided to pick another midfielder. This time they decided to get Luis Agüero from Columbus, and this is also another smart decision because Luis Agüero is considered one of the most hardworking player in this team. I mean, they basically now have two of the most hardworking player in this team with Victor Uyola and now Luis Agüero, and that he is also a guy that can be not only hardworking but also a guy that can really boss that midfield. So I kind of expect that he could potentially be a starter for this team, and if he's not a starter, I think he could be a good option in terms of bring off the bench if Miami decided in this offseason to also focus on trying to build and spend some money on that midfield. Then finally, in the final pick of their expansion draft for Miami, they decided to get Seattle Sounders backup goalkeeper Brian Meredith, and I have a feeling he could be a regular starter too, because I look at the Inter Miami roster as of now and they haven't got a goalkeeper yet, and I'm assuming probably they will eventually get a goalkeeper, but they're not going to like get that, probably won't be the biggest priority for them to focus. I mean, when you look at these previous expansion team, you know, goalkeeping position is not their biggest priority. I think the only team that I remember that really kind of valued that goalkeeper position as a big priority and really split the cash in terms of getting a decent goalkeeper is Atlanta when they got Brad Guzan. But other than that, you know, when you look at LAFC, NYCFC, Minnesota, and FC Cincinnati, goalkeeping wasn't really their biggest kind of spending asset. So, you know, I guess with Brian Meredith, they select him here, I think he could be a guy that would be a regular starter. And that this could be kind of something very similar to what LAFC done, where, you know, LAFC, they decided to get one of the backup goalkeeper for the Seattle Sounder in Tyler Miller, and it of course worked out very well. And that in this case, they're doing, Inter Miami is kind of doing the same thing, getting a backup goalkeeper from the Seattle Sounders, and we shall see if this, of course, work out. Now, Brian Meredith is a little bit older than Tyler Miller. I think he's already 30 years old now, but, you know, it'd be interesting to see, since he's been in the league for a long time, maybe that veteran presence can be something, a factor, and could be something that Miami could look at him and use and view him as a decent goalkeeper. Now, moving on into Nashville in terms of the five players that they selected. Now, in the first player they selected is striker Abu Dinladi from Minnesota United. Now, this one, I'm kind of a little bit stunned that they, of course, decided to select him. You know, Dinladi, he was a player that, when he came into the league from Minnesota, had a lot of hype, and that he was definitely a player that Minnesota thought that he could potentially continue to develop while scoring a lot of goals and assisting a lot in his first year. And then he basically fell off a cliff, and he basically was a guy that, you know, wasn't as impactful as they thought it would be. And I think there was also a point where he suffered a injury early on, which I think that might be one of the reasons why it led to his major setback. And that I think Minnesota, you know, not only they decided to leave him on the unprotected list, but most likely they were thinking about release him either way or trying to sell him to another team because they know that he doesn't really have a future with the club. But it seemed like Nashville kind of helped Minnesota's case in terms of trying to snatch off one of their striker that is pretty much now an outcast. But at the same time, you know, Dinlady with him just kind of fell off a cliff after he had that good rookie season. This is definitely a high risk for Nashville to do, and that if this is going to be the young striker that they're going to use, and that if they're not going to get another striker and kind of do something that FC Cincinnati did, which is looking at a striker that they thought it was promising and that it could be, well, in FC Cincinnati case, they thought Fernando Ardican still got it, but it turns out, you know, they found out that he has nothing left in the tank. And now, in this case, they would think that maybe with Dinlady moving to a new club, he might have a change of scenery and that it could really get him back to where he was in his rookie season and develop to be a very promising player. But at the same time, I don't know. I mean, this looks like a very big risk kind of move. And I'll tell you later on in another player that they selected that they also select what a young striker that, you know, I kind of feel like if Nashville is going to this into this direction where they are selecting a young striker and it is of course going to be part of their future, then maybe this guy might be a better option than the guy that they got in the first pick in Abu Dinlady. Now in the second pick they drafted Zarek Valentin from the Portland Timbers, but he will not play a single minute for Nashville because right after they drafted him, they immediately trade him to the Dynamo along with $75,000 in 2021, and that in exchange for sending Zarek Valentin to the Dynamo, they get Joe Willis in return. And I think this is definitely a good deal for both of these teams. I mean, for the Dynamo, they get a versatile fullback and center back player that has been one of the best versatile player in the league. And that for Nashville, you know, they're getting Joe Willis, that is a veteran goalkeeper, a very solid goalkeeper for the Dynamo. And that, I know they kind of did had to pay a little bit extra, but, you know, I think this is definitely a good deal for both of these teams. Although I feel like maybe they could, if they were gonna try to maybe go for a fullback, you know, and that they of course select Zarek Valentin, I feel like they probably would have been better off with just keeping him because, as I said, he is one of the most versatile player in the league, and he's a very good versatile player when he was with the Portland Timbers. But at the same time, they also get veteran goalkeeper Joe Willis that, you know, I think with the way that they are thinking that maybe their defense is going to be a little bit leaky this year and that they could maybe see what FC Cincinnati is doing and that they didn't really get like a decent goalkeeper that kind of protect a relatively leaky defense, they of course decided to get Joe Willis, who, you know, as I said, he is a very solid goalkeeper and will be able to at least, if Nashville does not get a good defense, at least they won't be like FC Cincinnati, which is just concede a bunch of goals like that. But the third pick for Nashville is Joel Anababa from the New England Revolution. And again, this is another one that I kind of is a little bit head scratch. And probably this one is the one that I think is the most head scratch out of all the picks that both of these team play or both of these team pick throughout this expansion draft. And you know, Anababa is not a bad player for New England, but he's kind of a just almost a journeyman. Like, he's been pretty much with a lot of club and have been really kind of settled for most of the club that he has joined. So with him going to Nashville, is this going to be the same thing? And that, you know, there's times that he could be a decent defender last year that I've seen him, and there are times where he looked like a very bad defender. So, you know, that's kind of interesting to see why they exactly thought about getting him. I guess maybe they decided to get him because he's kind of like another versatile player that could help them in terms of their roster. But if they're going to get a kind of a versatile center back and right back, I would definitely pick Zara Valentin over Jarrell Anababa any day of the week. Now, in the fourth pick that they choose is another one where they're going to be choosing a player that is not going to play a single minute with them and that they decide to trade him to another team. And that player is going to be Brandon Vasquez from Atlanta United, but he's going to be traded to FC Cincinnati in exchange for 150,000 TAM in 2020 and 50,000 general allocation money in 2021. And remember how I said earlier that, you know, if when you look at the draft pick that Nashville has selected during this expansion draft, and it seemed like there's two draft picks that they selected are just something that they have in mind of getting these young kind of promising striker into their roster and hope to develop them. Well, Brandon Vasquez is another one of them alongside with Abu Dinlani. And as I said a couple of minutes ago, if I would have choose a guy that, you know, if they're thinking about developing a young striker that could potentially fulfill his potential, it would definitely I would definitely pick Brandon Vasquez over Abu Dinlani. But apparently Nashville thinks that they need some extra target allocation money and some GAM money and kind of cover a little bit of the cost that they have to pay to the Dynamo to try to get Joe Willis. That's why they decided to send Brandon Vasquez to FC Cincinnati. And I'm definitely going to be interested to see how he does with Cincinnati, and that knowing Cincinnati desperately needs some attacking pieces. I think Vasquez, you know, at times when he was with Atlanta, he definitely showed some promise that he could definitely be one of the better striker in the league. You know, this is definitely a great deal for FC Cincinnati, and that at least now he's going to be getting much more playing time, and that this could really be a time that he could be finding out, and we could also find out if he is a decent kind of player that can really fulfill the potential of what we think he could be, one of the best striker in this league. Then finally, in terms of their Nashville expansion draft, they decided to choose Jimmy Madrona from Sporting KC. And this is another versatile player that can play in the fullback position, can play center back, or he can even play holding midfielder too. And there was even one point of the season where SKC, you know, they were in an injury crisis. They had to not only put Jimmy Madrona out of his natural position, but they decided to put him as a striker, which was kind of a little bit interesting. But hey, you know, it kind of did work out in a bit, and that it just kind of also explained why he is also a guy that I think not a lot of people value him as a very good versatile player. And that, you know, I think Nashville, when they saw that he could be a very good versatile player, and that in case throughout the season, if they're going to have some injuries that they're going to have to deal with, they can always put him as a guy that could be replacing a guy that is currently injured because of the versatility, and that he's also a very decent player in terms of that. So yeah, there you have it. That is pretty much it for the expansion draft. Let me know in the comments below, what do you think of all these picks? I mean, in my opinion, if I have to kind of pick my verdict of who actually did better in the expansion draft out of these two teams, I would say Inter Miami, knowing the fact that when you look at the players that they got, it's kind of more high profile and some that you think that they could definitely be a regular starter for their team. But again, you know, we've seen before that just because you, of course, pick a lot of good player that could be regular starter for your team doesn't mean that it always work out. And that, you know, for Nashville, even though when you look at the players that they pick, you know, really they only get to keep Abu Dinlani, Anababa, and also Madrenda, and that it's definitely not as high profile as I guess maybe Nashville is not really prioritizing the expansion draft, and knowing the fact that they think that this year expansion draft is not as deep as previous, they might think about going into the trade window and going into the trade market to get their own kind of talent so that they can, of course, get a very decent team heading into the upcoming season. But yeah, let me know in the comments below, what do you think of the expansion draft and what do you think of these picks? And yeah, hope you guys enjoyed this video and I will see you guys next time.